Morning. This morning I'm going to be reading John 9, starting in verse 1. As he went along, he saw a man blind from birth. His disciples asked him, "Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind?" "Neither this man nor his parents sinned," said Jesus, "but this happened so that the work of God might be displayed in his life. As long as it is day, we must do the work of him who sent me. Night is coming when no one can work. While I am in the world, I am the light of the world." Having said this, he spit on the ground, made some mud with the saliva, and put it on the man's eyes. "Go," he told him, "wash in the pool of Siloam." So the man went and washed and came home seeing. His neighbors and those who had formerly seen him begging asked, "Isn't this the same man who used to sit and beg?" Some claimed that he was. Others said, "No, he only looks like him." But he himself insisted, "I am the man." "How then were your eyes opened?" they demanded. He replied, "The man they called Jesus made some mud and put it on my eyes. He told me to go to Siloam and wash. So I went and washed, and then I could see." "Where is this man?" they asked him. "I don't know," he said. They brought to the Pharisees the man who had been blind. Now the day on which Jesus had made the mud and opened the man's eyes was a Sabbath. Therefore, the Pharisees also asked him how he had received his sight. "He put mud on my eyes," the man replied, "and I washed, and now I see." Some of the Pharisees said, "This man is not from God, for he does not keep the Sabbath." But others asked, "How can a sinner do such miraculous signs?" So they were divided. Finally, they turned again to the blind man. "What have you to say about him?" "It was your eyes he opened." The man replied, "He is a prophet." The Jews still did not believe that he had been blind and received his sight until they sent for the man's parents. "Is this your son?" they asked. "Is this the one you say was born blind? How is it that now he can see?" "We know he is your son," the parents answered, "and we know he was born blind, but how can see now, or who opened his eyes?" "We don't know," ask him. "He is of age, he will speak for himself." His parents said this because they were afraid of the Jews, for already the Jews had decided that anyone who acknowledged that Jesus was the Christ would be put out of the synagogue. That was why his parents said, "He is of age, ask him." A second time they summoned the man who had been blind. "Give glory to God," they said. "You know this man is a sinner." He replied, "Whether he is a sinner or not, I don't know. One thing I do know, I was blind, but now I see." Then they asked him, "What did he do to you? How did he open your eyes?" He answered, "I have told you already, and you did not listen. Why do you want to hear it again? Do you want to become his disciples too?" Then they hurled insults at him and said, "You are this fellow's disciple. We are disciples of Moses. We know that God spoke to Moses, but as for this fellow, we don't even know where he comes from." The man answered, "Now that is remarkable. You don't know where he comes from, yet he opened my eyes. We know that God does not listen to sinners. He listens to the godly man who does his will. Nobody has ever heard of opening the eyes of a man born blind. If this man were not from God, he could do nothing." To this they replied, "You are steeped in sin as at birth. How dare you lecture us?" And they threw him out. Jesus heard that they had thrown him out, and when he found him, he said, "Do you believe in the Son of Man?" "Who is he, sir?" the man asked. "Tell me so that I may believe in him." Jesus said, "You have now seen him. In fact, he is the one speaking with you." Then the man said, "Lord, I believe," and he worshipped him. Jesus said, "For judgment I have come into this world, so that the blind will see, and those who see will become blind." Some Pharisees who were with him heard him say this and asked, "What are we blind to?" Jesus said, "If you were blind and would not, if you were blind, you would not be guilty of sin. But now that you claim you can see, your guilt remains."
Thank you, Benji, for reading our text for the morning, which will be John's Gospel, chapter 9, and we'll see the Lord Jesus as the Master of Misfortune. Number of announcements for this week. We want to rejoice with our friends the Gorehouses on the arrival of a new grandson. Briggs Ryan Eisner was born on September 18th at 5:13 p.m., weighing 8 pounds, 12 ounces, 20 and 3 quarters inches long. And I believe that Jim and Linda are in Germany even as we speak, enjoying their grandchildren. Busy week in the life of First Baptist Church. We're here this morning for morning worship. Later tonight, there'll be an elders meeting by Zoom. And Monday morning, tomorrow morning, will be a memorial service for Bill Worthing. In the evening, there'll be a group of people gathering to work on the float. Wednesday is the first day of MOPS Bible study. Mary's going to be coming soon and sharing a highlight of the ministry, and she may talk about that, but there's a Bible study that is now meeting every other week as a result of that ministry, for which we are grateful. 86 kids at Awana last week. Wednesday night will be Awana at 6:30. Youth group also at 6:30, prayer and Bible study. We would invite you to participate as you're able. Thursday, CBS will be here in the morning. Friday night, a ladies' bonfire at Hannah Carson's home. And then as we look ahead to next Sunday, it will be the first Sunday of the month, we will be having communion, but we will do communion at the beginning of the service. Our kids will stay with us, so parents, it might be a good opportunity for you to talk with your children about that communion service as we will be meeting together. Also, October is the beginning of our missions month, and you can see that we're going to be fairly busy. Sunday school will be combined all next month, every single week, and we're inviting children from first grade all the way up to participate in combined Sunday school, with one exception. So if you have something to write with, you might want to put an asterisk beside October 15th. On the 15th, the kids who would normally go to junior church will be, or who would normally be in Sunday school, will be having a time together, and I believe they're going to start working on their Christmas program. But the 15th would be the exception to that. Otherwise, we're all going to enjoy Sunday school together through the month of October. You'll notice in conjunction with the Missions Month, there's Woodcutting Day. You see that in the middle of your bulletin on Saturday, October the 14th, from 8:30 until noon. And there's a sign-up sheet in the back. And if you have questions, see TJ about that. Going to be working on the float this Monday night. We're still looking for candy to pass out. We're looking for people to walk in the float. You can see that in the bulletin. If you have questions or are willing to help, please see Wendy Witter. Also, as we begin October, we'll be having our women's Bible study, men's Bible study. Ladies, it looks like your group is going to be quite large. That's a wonderful thing. Fellas, I don't think our Bible study group is quite as large, so maybe a few more guys would be willing to come one evening a month and enjoy a time of fellowship and study together. As we go to prayer, I want to begin by reading a card of thanks, and it says this: "Dear church family, I would like to thank you for your many prayers for me while I have been laid up with a back injury and surgery. We appreciate the cards, food visits, and other acts of kindness shown to us during this time as we waited on God. We are so thankful for God's healing in his perfect time. With love, Lori Norris." And I will tell you, on Wednesday, I was a little shocked when I saw her husband Gary come along the sidewalk on MOPS Day, and I thought, well, maybe Lori sent Gary to fill her spot. No, he was just the chauffeur. Lori was here, and she's here this morning, for which we are grateful and thank the Lord for his help in her life. And again, why do we pray? Because God invites us to. He knows, he cares, He answers. Continue to pray for our friend B. Abbott, who is, I believe, still at the Nuevo Medical Care Facility. Jim Brown is doing better here as well this morning. We're grateful for that. We've been praying for Randy Seaton. He continues to recover. Tim Henry has completed his radiation treatments. All things for which we praise the Lord. Some of you have known about our friend Bill Johnson, who had a stroke several months ago. His health was going up and down, and finally the Lord revealed his plan for Bill's life. Bill went home to be with the Lord last Thursday night. His services will be at First Baptist Church Nuevo, I believe, on Friday. But Bill and his wife Judy were friends of First Baptist Church. They participated in our building project, for which we are grateful. And again, as believers, it's certainly difficult for a family. It's never easy to say goodbye here on earth. But God's word promises that for a believer to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. And so I have no idea what a worship service is like in heaven, but can you imagine? No problems with the sound system. I doubt that anyone's choosing not to participate because it's not their favorite song. In the presence of the Lord Jesus, with brothers and sisters in Christ, enjoying him forever. What a hope is ours. Let's continue to pray for the young man named Riker, who we know of through the MOPS ministry. He was at DeVos last week having testing. Diana Beebe is asking that we pray for her niece. Also, tomorrow will be the memorial service for Bill Worthing at 11 o'clock, and you would be welcome to be here if you are able. Our friend Daniel Crabb, Tim and Barb's son, is in the hospital again. I don't know what number hospitalization this is, maybe 6 or 7 of recent vintage. Again, he has a blockage due to his struggle with Crohn's disease and other issues. So pray for Daniel. He'll probably need to be in the hospital for a number of days before things clear up and he can be released back home and back to work. But it certainly is an ongoing struggle for him, and I wouldn't doubt that he's getting a bit frustrated. So let's make sure that we're storming the throne of grace on Daniel's behalf. We're glad you're here this morning. Trust that you're ready to worship together, to hear God's word. Let's begin our service with a word of prayer, shall we? Father, how grateful we are that we can come into your presence because you invite us to. Father, I thank you that your word tells us that you know what we need before we even ask, yet you long for us to bring our words of worship. And so, God, we want to acknowledge who you are. We want to acknowledge you as the creator God. We want to acknowledge you as a creative God. What a beautiful day today is. The sun is shining, the sky is blue, and we are able to be together. Thank you for the freedom that we have in this country to gather and to worship without fear. Father, I would ask that we would take advantage of that we would desire to worship you with reckless abandon this morning, that we would be ready to lift our voices in song, for indeed you are worthy. We would be prepared to learn from your word and seek to be more conformed to the image of your beloved Son. Father, thank you that you care about the details of our lives. You know when we're sick. You know when we're in the hospital. You know when we're having surgery. And Father, sometimes we pray and we ask you to provide a healing touch for someone, and you do. So we are so grateful, Lord, for your work in Lori's life. Thank you that she's here this morning and gaining strength. Father, we would ask that would continue to bless Jim Brown as he is still recovering, Lord, from a surgery that he had 19 months ago. But again, Lord, we're grateful for what you're doing in his life, for helping Tim get through his radiation treatments, for your help in Randy Seaton's life as he's recovered from his surgery. Again, you're not obligated to do any of these things, so we want to say thank you. We're also grateful, Father, for the hope that is ours as followers of Jesus Christ. to know that your Son, when he was here on this earth, said, I am the resurrection and the life, and those who believe in him will never die. Now, in announcements today, I mentioned several deaths, the death of Bill Johnson, the death of Bill Worthing. Yet, Father, they are more alive today than they have ever been, because we believe that your word is true, and your word says that they are alive and well in your presence. Father, I thank you for that hope. Would ask for the families as they grieve, grateful that for believers that we do not grieve as do the rest, because we have hope. Lord, if there's anyone here this morning that does not know Jesus as their Savior, I would pray that today would be the day that they would recognize that without a Savior, they're just like the main character in our sermon this morning. They are spiritually blind, without hope. And we see what Jesus did. As the light of the world, he made blind eyes see. Father, we're grateful for that. We commit our friend Daniel to you, Lord. Daniel Crabb. He's been in and out of the hospital so much lately, and Father, would ask that you would provide a healing touch to his body. And Father, would ask that perhaps there could be more long-term answers to treat his condition so that this doesn't continue to happen. On the other hand, Lord, we know that you're in control. We know that you know what's going on, and we know that whether we understand it or not, you have your purpose, you have your plan. So cause us to be men and women who would pray, Father, not our will, but yours be done. We commit this service to you, Lord, asking for the name of your Son, Jesus, to be glorified. Meet us where we are. Provide for us what we need. And we'll be careful to give you all the praise and glory for what you accomplish in us and through us. We pray these things in Jesus' precious name. Amen.
Amen. Well, we're going to begin the singing portion of our worship with the House of the Lord. So if you can, stand with us this morning and let's sing House of the Lord together.
We worship the God who is. We worship the God who is.
house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. Continue with My Jesus, I Love Thee.
Thank you.
that your prayer? No turning back from the great Jesus who is our living hope, right? So our last song is going to be that song, Living Hope, that we've sung many times. But, you know, the words of that are, hallelujah. The chorus says, hallelujah, praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah, death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. No matter what you face, no matter what trials you face in life, just remember that God is there with you, and he gave you the living hope in Jesus Christ. So sing that with us today, living hope.
Thank you.
hope. You may be seated.
I'm so excited again to have an opportunity as your MOPS coordinator to share with you kind of a lot of exciting things that are happening in MOPS this year. So this year, MOPS International celebrated its 50th anniversary. So for nearly 50 years, God has used MOPS to share Jesus with moms, kids, and families around the world. As we approach the half century of impact, we recognize that shifting cultural norms and a global pandemic are creating a pivotal moment of opportunity in the MOPS program. The rate of suicide among moms is skyrocketing. Families are in financial crisis, and kids are navigating unprecedented levels of anxiety, largely related to technology use. What moms and families need more than anything right now is good news, the good news of Jesus, and the relief that comes when they learn that MOPS offers them practical tools and resources to help them with their emotional, relational, and spiritual needs. We focus on reaching moms in our community because moms have a critical role in introducing their families to who Jesus is. If you look at the slideshow above there, MOPS did a study this year, kind of looking at the impact that moms have in our community and the program. 82% of families say they started going to church because mom decided that it was important. 77% of adults say their mom is the most influential person in their faith life. While the needs of moms in early motherhood haven't changed, they have grown more complex in our digital and isolated age. Moms are experiencing tectonic shifts in the state of family, faith, and relational connection. 89% of moms feel that they have a lack of support. There are 700 million children ages 5 and under around the globe, and here's some things that are happening with the moms that are raising those kids. There's emotional, relational, and spiritual poverty. 78% of moms report debilitating symptoms of anxiety or depression. 1 in 3 moms experience anger that sometimes results in harm to their children. 79% of moms worry that they drink too much. 1 in 8 moms are solo parenting. 58% of women report needing mentoring but aren't sure where to find it. 3 in 4 moms feel desperately lonely and report having 1 or no close friends. 4 in 10 young moms feel the church is not important or relevant in their lives. Only 12% of moms say they read their Bible on a weekly basis. And 3 in 4 churches report declining attendance among young families. It is a huge problem. And MOPS encourages these young moms of young children to realize their potential as mothers, women, and leaders in relationship with Jesus and partnering with the local church. Since 2016, MOPS has celebrated over 46,000 women making the decision to follow Christ. That's a staggering number. When we begin to look at what the MOPS program does, in terms of emotional development, 83% of women report that their MOPS membership has increased their confidence in their parenting abilities. 90% say their MOPS membership provided them with practical tools to be a better mom. 80% express their MOPS experience decreased their anxiety about being a mom. In terms of relational development, 6 in 10 report participation in MOPS improved their marriages. 9 in 10 say MOPS provided them with a supportive community. 8 in 10 indicate their MOPS experience has provided them with a mentor. When we look at spiritual development, which to me is obviously the most important piece of all of this, 95% of women report their relationship with Jesus was supported and deepened by a MOPS program. 73% say that they have shared their faith with another unbelieving adult in the past 6 months, and 35,000 women indicate they have made a decision to trust and follow Jesus Christ since 2016. So we need MOPS more than ever right now. The numbers are staggering and show that we need MOPS. As a result of these findings, MOPS has decided decided to get a new name. The acronym MOPS, Mothers of Preschoolers, has narrowed over the last 10 to 15 years, basically to mean only moms that have 3 to 5 year olds that attend school, not the broader inclusion of all moms. All moms need MOPS. All moms are welcome to MOPS, and the name needs to reflect that. Also, MOPS has expanded globally, and the name MOPS is often not translatable, and sometimes when it is, it has negative connotations. So, basically this year, now, MOPS is going to be called MomCo. The central focus of MOPS has always been to create a mom community that provides opportunities for moms to encounter Jesus. We are a pioneering mom community with this mission, and really the first of its kind. Our specialty is creating a transformational mom community. Therefore, our new name is shorthand for the mom community, MomCo. MOPS will soon be known as MomCo, the mom community. But the change won't officially take place until next fall, but we're excited to see the movement occurring within the organization. Our local MOPS program has already done this. We've had moms of all ages. We haven't said that, you know, if you've got kids and preschoolers, then you can't come anymore. So we've really opened and broadened our community to include all moms. We're excited that MOPS International is doing that as well with their name change. So as we begin to think about where MOPS is right now, we think about what we did last year. And last year, we started out the year by introducing the theme, We Go Together. A Bible verse last year was from Romans 12:18. If it is possible, as far as it depends on you, live at peace with everyone. Last year's theme was about transformation. So we encouraged our moms to be gracious, to show up, and to expect good things. This year, our MOPS theme is to say yes. Our theme verse is Zechariah 4:10. Do not despise these small beginnings, for the Lord rejoices to see the work begin. This year, we intend to help our moms learn to be easily delighted, befriend discomfort, and to be here now. Our leadership team at MOPS is excited about this year's theme and the ability to walk alongside moms, many unchurched and unsaved, to help them learn about how God is the key to allowing us to say yes to Him. Currently, we have 67 moms and 98 kids registered for MOPS. We had our first meeting last week, and it was very successful. We were amazed at all the new moms that we had in the room. When we looked at the list, there were so many moms we didn't know. There were many that we did know, but there were a lot of new moms, and that's pretty exciting for us. One mom approached me after MOPS this past week and said, "I was worried about coming to MOPS because I don't believe in God. But when I came to my first meeting, I felt like it was a place I could belong and still get a lot out of." That is a mom that we're going to have an opportunity to introduce to Jesus. We're also excited to announce that MOPS is now offering a monthly Bible study for our moms who want to go deeper in their faith. This was actually a request from surveys that we do. So MOPS is not only introducing women to Jesus, but it's really pushing them to want to learn more about Him as well. So our first meeting is this Wednesday morning, and we already have 37 moms signed up. The study is called Grace Duration, which is grace for the rest of your life. It reviews a new truth each meeting that's based solidly in Scripture and creatively visualized to lead the women to experience God's grace. The approach reinforces familiar scriptures and teachings to then become real solutions to the struggles that moms face every day. MOPS is committed to finding every opportunity to bring important faith conversations to our moms, because we passionately believe that if you reach moms, then you can reach the next generation. I'm so grateful that our church cares deeply about women and children and knows the impact a mom can make in her home, her community, and ultimately in the kingdom of God. Thank you for joining our MOPS leadership team this year and the energizing work of bringing the good news of Jesus to even more moms in our community. Once again, I'm here to ask you to pray for our MOPS program, to pray for our leaders, and to pray for all of our moms. Also, I would really like to ask if you're willing to volunteer some of your time in our MOPS program. We could certainly use you. Our MOPS program continues to grow, and as it does, we need more and more volunteers to help support our moms and their children. We're offering childcare for moms who attend our monthly Bible study as well. We could really use volunteers for that program. That's only an hour and a half commitment once a month, but it could be a life-changing experience for the mom who gets to attend because you were there willing to serve. If you feel that you can spare extra time to help us with that, you can see me, Emily Strotman, or Becky Seaton, as we'd love to have you be a part of our volunteer team. We at MOPS want to leave you with a big thank you for all the support you've given us and continue to give us year after year. After church today, we will have cookies in the back for everyone, along with a sign-up sheet if you feel moved to help us. I want to leave you with one more thing. As a mom community, MomCo, we raise our kids and one another. We boldly elevate motherhood. We embrace the unexpected and imperfect. We understand that our direction is more important than our speed. We celebrate often and loudly. We know every mom has a place with us. And we follow Jesus and invite others to follow along on that journey. Thanks.
All right, kiddos, you can be dismissed to junior church. Thank you, Mary, for the update. And I will tell you, my favorite time of year is fall, and it is actually autumn. I think that happened on Friday. But one of the things I love about this time of year is we get back into the school year routine at First Baptist Church. That means Awana is back. I think the first week there were over 90 kids. Last week, 80 kids. What an opportunity to impact lives for the cause of Christ. Last Wednesday was the first MOPS meeting, and to see the moms and the kiddos coming because they need fellowship. They need mentors. And since I'm the doorman, I get to see most of the people who come. And you realize that there are some moms who show up on Wednesday morning, and if they weren't here, they'd be just fine. And there are others that are hanging on by a thread. I'm proud of the way this church has embraced both the Awana ministry for so long and the MOPS ministry. And I know that there's lots of stuff. People are asking for your time and for your ability. But being engaged in ministries that are touching lives, I promise you, when you stand before the judgment seat of Christ, you won't be apologizing. Well, Lord, I volunteered and I helped with Awana. Maybe I shouldn't have done that. Well, I was here at MOPS. Maybe I shouldn't have been serving other people. That's exactly what we are called to do. You have your Bibles this morning. Please turn again to John's Gospel, chapter 9. The Gospel of John, chapter 9, and this is the sixth miracle in our series, The Miracles of Jesus. You'll remember that in John's Gospel, there are seven miracles that occur prior to the resurrection of Jesus Christ, and they are included in John's Gospel for one specific reason. John tells us in John 20, chapter 20, verse 30, "Therefore, many other signs Jesus also performed in the presence of the disciples, which are not written in this book. But these have been written so that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that believing you may have life in his name." And thus far, we have seen Jesus as the master of quality, the master of distance, the master of time, the master of quantity, and the master of nature, or natural law. The feeding of the 5,000 and Jesus walking on water that we talked about last week, those two miracles are tied together. You might remember that the disciples, Jesus sent the disciples across the sea because the Jews were coming to make Jesus king by force. They thought having King Jesus would be great. Heal the sick, feed us three squares a day. What could be better? But between Jesus walking on the water and the miracle that we get to today, there are several things that happen that are worthy of brief comment. For example, in John chapter 6, following Jesus walking on the water, he gives what is known by many scholars as the bread of life discourse. In John 6:35, Jesus says to them, "I am the bread of life." Interesting that Jesus would use that description of himself, the bread of life. And there's a good reason why he did. Bread is a staple food. unless you have medical reasons not to eat bread. And even for those of us that try to go on a diet and do low carb, bread's a part of everyday life. Bread is a staple food. Rich people eat bread. You know what poor people do? They eat bread. Bread is consumed by everyone. Just out of curiosity, how many of you have had bread already today? May I see your hands? All right. I know some of you didn't play, but we've already had bread today, and you might have a sandwich for either lunch or supper or dinner, or we eat bread every day. It's a daily food. Do you know there's nothing like a warm roll? You cut it in half and you put a little butter, not margarine. If you're gonna eat a roll, use butter. And that butter melts and you take a bite, that'll set you free. It's satisfying. It's bread is a wonderfully satisfying food. You also realize bread is not easily made. There's a story, it's a nursery rhyme called The Little Red Hen. You remember that? First, the field has to be planted, right? And then the grain has to be harvested. And then the grain has to be crushed and made into flour. And then it all has to be mixed together. And then it has to be put in the oven. You know, when Jesus says, I am the bread of life, providing the salvation that we so enjoy, that is so satisfying, that is so filling, wasn't easy. But he did it because he loves us. As we continue in John's gospel, we get to John chapter 8, and there's the time when Jesus encounters the woman who is caught in adultery. Caught in the very act. You know, I sometimes wonder, where was the man? If the woman was caught in the very act, there had to be a man. Where'd he go? He doesn't show up in John chapter 8. And do you remember when the religious leaders are trying to trap Jesus? And they say, according to our law, she deserves to die. And you remember the text of Scripture in John chapter 8. Don't take my word for it. Later today, read it yourself. Jesus, the Bible says, writes on the ground with his finger. I don't know about you, but I'd like to know what he wrote. Wouldn't you? I wonder, since they had to tell Jesus, you know, Moses, the law of Moses says this. I wonder if he used his finger to write the law of Moses on the ground the same way the finger of God wrote the law for Moses the first time. Like, you don't need to tell me the law, I wrote it. And then you remember Jesus said to them, the one who is without sin, you cast the first stone. And then the Bible says he wrote on the ground again. Did you ever wonder what he wrote? I do. And I wonder if he wrote, this is Bill's sin. This is Steve's sin. This is John's sin. Because you know what happened? They all left, from the oldest of them to the youngest. Don't you love the gracious words of the Lord Jesus? You can imagine that woman is kind of bracing herself for the first strike of a stone, and the next thing she hears is the voice of Jesus. Where are those who condemn you? And Jesus says, neither do I condemn you, but go and sin no more. Also in John's Gospel chapter 8, we hear the declaration of Jesus that I am the light of the world. And as chapter 8 ends, he once again asserts his deity. Remember, there are some people who say Jesus never claimed to be God in the Gospels. Oh, yes, he did. Multiple times. In fact, John's Gospel, chapter 8, verse 58, Jesus said to them, truly, truly, I say to you, before Abraham was born, I am. Therefore, they picked up stones to throw at him. You want to know why? Because when Jesus said that, before Abraham was born, I am. Jesus is saying, I am God. And the Jews picked up stones because that would have been blasphemy in their minds. John 8:59, therefore they picked up stones to throw at him, but Jesus hid himself and went out of the temple. Commentator named Merrill Tenney has divided John's Gospel chapter 9 into four sections, and those sections are going to serve as our main points this morning. First of all, we look at the case. The case. The key person in this miracle is a man who was born blind. Now, if you were paying attention as Benji was reading, there are several characteristics about this man who was born blind. He was blind from birth. Neither he nor anyone else could change his condition. We'll realize as we're reading the narrative that this blind man is outside of the temple. He had to beg for his sustenance. You know, since he was a blind man, do you notice what the text says? Chapter 9, verse 1, as he, Jesus, passed by, he saw a man blind from birth. Jesus saw the man. What did the man see? You can tell me. Nothing. The man saw nothing. Why? Because he was blind. And his disciples asked him, Rabbi, who sinned? This man or his parents, that he would be born blind? You know, another thing that we see about this blind man is the way that other people perceived him. Here are the disciples, the followers of Jesus, the ones who have gone with him, who have walked with him, who have talked with him, who have seen the miracles. They see this man who was blind, blind from birth, and they say, Lord, we have a theological question. In fact, to the disciples, he was a pawn in a theological debate. Who sinned? We know someone sinned. Someone sinned that this misfortune would fall upon this man. Was it his parents or did he sin? Like many, they believed that God was a God who rewarded the good and delivered a retribution to the bad. So was this a punishment for his parents' sin? There were some Jews who actually believed in a form of reincarnation. So did this guy really do bad things in an earlier life, or did he sin in the womb so egregiously that God said, that's it, you're going to be blind? No concern for the individual, but a great concern over theological debate. It occurs to me, you know, sometimes we as believers, we get all caught up in our theological debates. For example, how does one come to salvation? Is it the unconditional election of God or the free will of man? Let's have a debate. Here's someone born blind. If they're going to get saved, is it because of the election of God or the free will of men? And we debate it back and forth, but you know what we never do? Share the gospel. Perhaps we ought to put the theological debate on the back burner and have a heart of compassion for the individual. Did you notice what verse 8 says about his neighbors? Verse 8 says, therefore, the neighbors and those who previously saw him as a beggar. To the disciples, he was a pawn. To his neighbors, he was just a beggar. A beggar, by definition, is one who lives by asking others for money or food, someone who is penniless, or even a wretched fellow. So the neighbors, when they thought about this man born blind, all that they thought about was the guy who stood on the road with his hand out. He was just a beggar, just a penniless individual. Later, we're going to see the Pharisees treat this man as a tool. He presents them with an opportunity to get back at Jesus. They had no concern for the man. The disciples had no concern for the man. The neighbors had no concern for the man. The Pharisees had no concern for the man. But the text of Scripture says, as he passed by, that is Jesus, he saw a man blind from birth. Aren't you glad that Jesus had compassion? Aren't you glad that Jesus saw the man? And listen to the response of Jesus when he was asked who sinned. Jesus said, verse 3, it was neither that this man sinned nor his parents, but it was so that the works of God might be displayed in him. Jesus has compassion on the man, and he says there's only one reason that he's blind, and it's so that the works of God may be displayed in him. He didn't sin. His parents didn't sin. But God intended to do a work in his life. The book of Job teaches us that misfortune does not automatically mean that there's a punishment from God. And the works of God would ultimately result in God's glory. Do you know what question one of the Westminster Shorter Catechism asks? Question one asks, what is the chief end of man? Because there were some commentators who were kind of upset, like it almost doesn't seem fair that this man would, God would allow this man to be born blind only so that he could have an encounter with Jesus. Except why do we exist? Why are we here? The chief end of man is to glorify God and enjoy him forever. To glorify God, what happens when we glorify God? We enhance God's reputation in the world. Do you know what we're talking about more than 2,000 years after this guy got healed? Him? He is enhancing God's reputation in the world to glorify God and enjoy him forever. Pastor Troy DeBruin writes, indeed, it is a beautiful statement that first question of the Westminster Shorter Catechism and the answer. Indeed, it is a beautiful statement. It reminds us of what we were created to do and that there isn't true enjoyment in doing it. God, the author and creator of life, created us to worship him, to glorify him in all things. But there is more here. By glorifying God, we find that we actually enjoy him. We find fellowship and communion with our Heavenly Father that is eternal in scope. This is our true contentment. Being created to glorify God doesn't just benefit God. Not that God could be enriched or benefit from us. No, rather, we find that we, the created finite being, are the ones who benefit infinitely. Jesus said there's one reason this man was born blind, that the works of God may be displayed in him. And what are those works? When you think of the works of God, what was it that was going to be displayed in the life of this man? A.W. Pink describes them to reveal the perfection. What are the works of God? To reveal the perfections of God and to minister to the needs of his creatures. The works of God are those things which are not only pleasing to God, but also decreed by God, his will. Peter reminds us an aspect of the decree of God or the will of God or the desire of God. Not wishing for any to perish, but for all to come to repentance. How blessed to know that the most glorious of all God's works is displayed in saving the lost and hell-deserving sinners. Because I'm sure you understand that this blind man has a spiritual application. He's a picture of anyone who doesn't have a relationship with Jesus Christ. He's blind spiritually. Here's something fun. Make sure that I'm not telling you something that isn't true. Look in the Gospels at all of the named healing miracles. We know that there are times where it says Jesus healed the sick. But take some time in the Gospels and look at every time there's a specific miracle of healing that is communicated, like a deaf man received the ability to hear, or a mute person received the ability to talk, or someone was healed of leprosy. If you make a list of how many times Jesus did what, does anyone know what healing ministry occurs most often in the Gospels? Anybody? A blind person receiving sight. Why did Jesus come? To save sinners. The most popular thing, the most popular miracle that is recorded that Jesus did is when there was someone who was blind who receives their sight. Because those of us who don't know Christ are spiritually blind, and Jesus came as the light of the world to give sight. And I wonder, when we see the blind man, in your neighborhood, at your place of work, that person that doesn't know the Lord Jesus Christ, they are therefore blind spiritually. How do you see them? Are they a pawn in your theological debate? Well, you know, do you know the things that they did? Do you know who they are? Are we like the neighbors who, oh, they're just a beggar. They're just an addict. They're just a drunk. Do we see them as a tool like the Pharisees did? Here's an opportunity to get the upper hand. Or will we, like Jesus, see them with compassion? The case. We also see the cure. Now, there was a cure that really wasn't a physical cure. It's not like, and Jesus took the man to the world-renowned ophthalmologist who did eye surgery and reattached his optic nerve. No. What'd Jesus do? He spits on the ground, mixes his spit with the dirt, he makes a little bit of clay, and he puts that clay on the man's eyes. Now, do know that there were some people who believed that the spittle of a very well-known or honorable person could have some curative powers. But that's not why Jesus spit on the ground, I'm pretty confident. Do you know what would happen if Jesus made clay and put clay on your eyes? Do you know what the condition of your ability to see would be, by the way? You couldn't see either. Maybe Jesus spit on the ground and made the clay and put it on the guy's face so that the guy could, remember he's blind, so that he could hear and feel that Jesus wanted to heal him. Maybe he put that on his face, which would encourage the guy to actually go to the pool and wash. And that's exactly what Jesus did. He made the clay, he put it on his eyes, and he said, now you go and you wash in the pool of Siloam. You know what the blind guy did? Kind of crazy. He went. I have very little medical training except first aid that anyone that is a normal person would know. I'm here to tell you that I'm pretty sure that spit and dirt is not something that you should put in your eyes. That's not going to help. I'm pretty sure if you're blind and you wash your face really, really good, that's not going to help. But the blind man believed Jesus. You ever wonder why Jesus told him to go wash in a pool, the pool of Siloam? I wonder if washing in the pool doesn't have a relationship with us. For example, in Ephesians chapter 5, if you've ever gone through premarital counseling or marriage counseling, you've probably heard this. Ephesians chapter 5, the Bible says, "Husbands, love your wives just as Christ also loved the church and gave himself up for her." What does husbands loving their wives have to do with a blind man and a pool? "So that he might sanctify her, having cleansed her by the washing of water with the word. So that he might present to himself the church in all her glory, having no spot or wrinkle or any such thing, that she would be holy and blameless." You see, what this blind guy needed, what a spiritually blind person needs, is to be washed by the water of the word. It's God's word that will tell us of God's holiness and perfection. It's in God's word where we are shown our sinful condition in need of a Savior. God's word tells us who that Savior is. God's word tells us that we must put our faith in him. The word tells us how to live lives that are pleasing to him. So I ask you this morning, are you like this blind man? Spiritually blind because you don't have a Savior? If you are, may I invite you to go wash in the water of his word. Thirdly, we see this man's confession. I love this guy because he makes a confession about what happened to him. And in his confession, he employed the KISS principle. Do you know what the KISS principle is? Keep it simple, Steve. Or you could use another word for the last S. Keep it simple. And that's what he did. For example, when the neighbors are talking about him, "Is he the one?" "Well, I don't know. He looks like the same guy." You know what the guy said? "Yeah, it's me." How hard was that? When they ask him, "How were your eyes opened?" He said, "Jesus made clay, anointed my eyes, said to wash. I washed. I received sight." That's it. They said, "Well, where is he?" He said, "I don't know." Do you realize sometimes the answer, "I don't know," is an absolutely perfectly good answer? Pharisees asked him, "How did you receive your sight?" He answered, "He applied clay to my eyes. I washed. I see." Question, "What do you say about him?" Answer, "He is a prophet." Question, they didn't believe the man, so they ask his parents. They answer, "He is of age. Ask him." They say one more time, "Give glory to God. We know that this man is a sinner." And here is my favorite confession of all. The man answered, "Whether he is a sinner or not, I do not know." I don't know. One thing I do know. Once I was blind, now I see. You could ask me stuff I don't know the answer to. But let me tell you something. I know this morning when I woke up, I was blind as a bat. I know bats really aren't blind, but bear with me. I couldn't see. Once I was blind, now I see. I know sometimes we're coming up on Missions Month and we talk about evangelism and sharing the gospel, and I wonder, have you Have you ever intentionally shared the good news of the gospel with someone else? And there, sometimes people, well, you know, I'd like to, but it makes me nervous. You know, people might ask questions, and there are silly questions, you know, like, hey, Joe, did Adam have a belly button? Man, I don't want to talk about the things of God because they might ask me a question like that. You know what you can answer? Did Adam have a belly button? I have an answer for that. I don't know. Once I was blind, but now I see. Can God make a rock so heavy that even he can't lift it? I don't know. But once I was blind, now I see. Sometimes people have harder questions like, why does God allow evil in the world? I don't completely understand, but here's what I know. Once I was blind, but now I see. Keep it simple. Maybe you memorize the ABCs of salvation, which isn't the same as the gospel, but it's the way to respond to the message of the gospel. You admit you're a sinner. You believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God who died for your sins, and you confess your belief to Christ. Or maybe you memorize the Romans Road so that when someone asks you, you can keep it simple, Steve, and share the Romans Road, Romans 3:23, all of sin, Romans 6:23a, the wages of sin is death, Romans 6:23b, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord, Romans 10:9, that if you confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Romans 5:1, therefore having been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. You know your story, right? I don't know a lot of things, but here's what I know. I used to be blind, but now I see. Yeah, I don't know about those other people at First Baptist Church. Yeah, I know that church got a lot of problems, but let me tell you about me. I know that Jesus changed my life. Well, what about? I don't know. Here's what I know. Could you do that? This blind man did. Finally, we see the consequences. Jesus says in John 9, verse 39, Jesus said, for judgment I came into this world so that those who do not see may see, and those who see may become blind. That's a wonderful thing. Why did Jesus come? So that the blind, the spiritual blind, can see. So that the lost can be saved. And even in the case of these Pharisees who thought they saw everything and knew everything, Jesus said, I came, I hope you become blind. Because you know what? When someone is blind, when Jesus is there, what can the result be? They can see. And then notice the faith of this blind man. When he was first asked, who opened your eyes? Do you remember what he said? Jesus. It was Jesus. And the Pharisees said, well, what do you think about Jesus? And he said, well, you know, I think he's a prophet. And as time goes on a little bit more, he says, for Jesus to be able to do that, he must be one who was sent from God. And then ultimately we see this blind man understanding that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God. You want to know why? Because he bowed down and worshiped. And I wonder, is our knowledge of who Jesus is growing? Is our relationship with him getting stronger? Are we willing to confess with simplicity, once I was blind, but now I see? When I see a blind person as I'm living my life, will I respond with the heart of the Lord Jesus, a heart of compassion, desiring that their spiritually blind eyes be opened? That's why John wrote the miracles in this gospel that he did. Therefore, many other signs Jesus also performed in the presence of the disciples, which are not written in this book. But these have been written so that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that believing, you may have life in his name. Father, we thank you this morning for your word. Father, we thank you that your Son came to do the works of God, and that those works of God include opening blind eyes. For those of us this morning here, Lord, that have had our spiritually blind eyes opened, I thank you. And I would ask that you would give us the courage and the desire to simply share that message. A lot of stuff I don't know, but this is what I know. I was blind, but now I see. Father, thank you for spiritual sight. Thank you that your Son Jesus is the light of the world, not only opening our eyes, but illuminating our paths so that we can live lives that are pleasing to you. Help us to do so this week. We ask for your help in the precious name of our Savior, the Lord Jesus. Amen. Thanks for being here this morning. Have a great week. We are dismissed.